talked about the Bible being the story of God's redemptive work in history. And to understand it that way, there's those ingredients we talked about, story, that make a story, you know, how things began, something goes wrong, how it gets remedied, what does that mean from that point on. And understanding this in the context, the way that God works inside that story is through covenant. And if you really get this, you begin to understand that, you know, who's ever seen one of these? Hovering sphere, huh? Yeah. They're kind of cool little things. You pull on it, it goes like this. And, you know, it certainly has a geometric thing, but I've used it before to talk about relationships and personal growth and stuff. And the key idea behind this is you can take any point on this thing. If you pull it, it expands all together, right? Just by the application of that pressure on one point. And covenant really does serve that function, understanding God's work through history and scripture. If you get a good grasp on what covenant is and what covenant means, it's going to open up for you truth all through scripture. It's going to deepen your understanding of God. It's going to help you connect with it. It's going to make sense out of so much of scripture for you in new and deeper ways. So glad you put the time into this. It's going to be fun. So ask your questions as we go along. And our God is a covenanting God. That's inescapable reality if you read the Bible at all. And that is unique as well. Christian, the God that we worship is different in any other way, that he makes covenant, and he is a faithful covenant keeper. And in the story that we're going to look at today, later on, it's important we set human rebellion and God's redemptive work in its full context. If we don't do that, it's like reading middle chapters of a book. And they may be interesting, but you're never really going to fully be able to tap into them and understand them without that. So in a little bit, we're going to go back to the story of Genesis, particularly Genesis 1 and 2. If you don't understand Genesis 1 and 2, if you don't see the beauty of it, you'll never understand the power of the redemptive work of God and the import of it, okay? So we're going to get there. And I said last week that Christianity is a revelatory faith, which is good news. That God wants to be known, and he takes the initiative to make himself known. Here's a scary thought. God is God, right? So if he wanted to deceive us all, there's nothing we could do about that. We would never know it, right? So isn't it good to know, as you read his self-disclosure, that he wants to be known and that he's a genuine God? And so as you look through scripture, he's revealing himself. When you look at the story of the Bible, it's a story of God saying, here's who I am. Here's what I'm like. Here's what I'm up to in the world. And covenant always plays a central role to that. And in the story of the Bible, the portions that make the story, you know, you have the creation, you have fall, you have redemption, and then eventually, you know, you're going to have the full consummation of God's creation. And creation is the starting point, okay? And when you think about Genesis 1 and 2, what's the catchword about creation? How's God describing himself? It's good, yeah. Some of it's very good, right? And then our first parents fall into rebellion, and that impacts the whole human race. And God responds to that out of his grace, and ultimately he's going to restore it. So each successive event in the covenant story of God builds on the preceding events. Creation is the environment that the fall tainted, okay? The fall is the context in which redemption affects things, right? And then the redemptive work of God is the ultimate consummation of God, that he's going to gather his redeemed to himself and everything else is going to be done away with, okay? So you have that restoration at the end. And that's a nutshell story of what God's up to in this world. And John, you asked the question, and some other groups did as well, that unfolding story takes place over centuries. You know, and it's not going to be completed until Jesus returns. Why? I don't know. I mean, you can try to make sense of that. There's a lot of little pieces of why. You know, God's working in history. I mean, to restore broken relationship, it's never a piece of information. There's got to be something deeper and more profound happening as a result of that, right? It's never just a conversation. So to restore a relationship with an entire human population, it just makes sense to me that that's going to be a drawn-out process, okay? But in the center of it, is Jesus. We talked about this last week, and I'm just going to summarize some of the things that we said last week. If you have questions on them, ask them. And primarily, the difference between the Old Testament and New Testament, the Old Testament looks forward to Jesus. Right? It all points towards him. The New Testament is the result of his coming. All right? And it's pointing to the consummation of things, the restoration of all things. And so the biblical story, we ask, what is Christianity? Jesus is the center of that story. And God's unstoppable goal, and this may, let this settle. What is God up to? What is Christianity? What is God up to? God's unstoppable goal is nothing less than the restoration, full restoration of his good creation. Not the getting rid of it, the creation, but getting rid of the sin that has damaged it and distorted it. Even to the point of the sin's effect on the human body. I mean, we look forward to a bodily resurrection. All right? God is restoring his physical creation, not just the spiritual kind of out there thing. All right? So that's what God's up to. That's where the story leads. And Jesus is the center of that. And a few things that he does, he makes God's story tangible. We talked about that last week. The Word became flesh. And when, you know, the first week of this series talked about abiding. I mean, there's got to be a tangible dynamic of that if it's going to be sustainable. If your faith is just all about ideas and thoughts and philosophies, it's going to wear you out. What keeps us coming to the table, what keeps us engaged in this story and in relationship with God, is that tangible dynamic that he is here. And he has made himself accessible to us. He does hear us. We can hear from him. That, you know, so Jesus makes all that possible. He makes the, you know, that tangible for us. And when you read the scripture writers are so committed to that. All throughout it. I mean, there are date markers in your Bible, you know. When so-and-so was ruler, when Pontius Pilate was in charge, right? I mean, if you were to write that today, it'd be like, you know, when Bill Clinton was president. So you have these historical markers because the Bible's real clear that God's redemptive plan is working itself out in the world in which we live. In history, God is at work, and history is in God's hand going somewhere. Does that make sense to you? Okay? So, you know, we need to keep that focus and be aware of that, or else our faith becomes this abstract, you know, just kind of spiritualized version of things, which has no real connect with what we're going to do later on tonight or tomorrow. All right? And then when we have that perspective and things, what happens or tends to happen with our faith when that's our vantage point is it's pretty much set on the side until the wheels fall off. And then we scramble and hope there's something there that's tangible and can help us. That really doesn't work very well, okay? It's not meant to, really. So, in space and time, God puts on human flesh, which, you know, one of the translations says Jesus robed himself in human flesh, and we talked about one of the images of covenant is this exchanging of robes, you know, which is an identification with each other. And think about that. Jesus robed himself in our flesh. And what's the scripture say about us? We are robed in his righteousness. So there's a participation in each other's realities and lives. There's a sharing of that. Okay? That was a side point. Jesus, and second thing about Jesus, he mediates the heart of the Father. And all the covenants have mediators. So that's something you just need to look at and be aware of. Jesus mediates the redemptive heart of the Father. So in Jesus, we see what the heart of the Father is like. Remember, the disciples asked him, I think it's John 14, show us the Father. What did Jesus say? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right? Making the Father known to us and the kingdom accessible is the particular business of Jesus. He comes in flesh to say, you know what, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The other part of that is, if you don't know Jesus, you're pretty much blind to who God is. You know? They are linked together by God's design. And then another thing that Jesus does, he makes the story our story. Because he is the Redeemer. He's the one that includes us. He is, in a sense, to use the typology of Moses, he is the Moses of the New Testament. He's God's representative, says, I've come to set you free. Right? Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. You able to hear me?
No problem.
All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to look at a couple of passages here. Everybody there? Okay, verses 19 and 20. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you received from God? You are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. And when you enter into relationship with God through Christ, that's the redemptive work. And redeem means to purchase back. And so the story of God's redemption, we are caught up into that the moment we're redeemed, that God purchases us into his community, into his family. All right? And then turn over to 1 Peter chapter 1. First of all, does that make sense to you, the Corinthians passage? You've been purchased. That's what redeemed means, to be bought back.
Always think of green stamps. I know most people.
Yeah, yeah. Well, this will give you a little comparison to green stamps. This passage we're going to look at now, 1 Peter chapter 1. All right. So before we look at this, when you're going to purchase something, what sets the price?
The value of it.
Yeah, the value of something is the price people will pay for it, right? That's kind of the market we live in. That there's a general thing. So with that in mind, let's look at these verses. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Okay? So Jesus makes the story of God's covenant redemptive plan on earth our story, but the cost of that was his own life. Okay? And there it is, purchased by his blood. Remember, we looked at that. One of the key elements of covenant making is bloodletting. All right? Make sense?
What chapter was that?
1
Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 21. 18. Okay? And then another thing Jesus does, again, he's not just the centerpiece of the New Testament, he's the centerpiece of the whole thing, which we just read here. You know, this goes all the way back. God always had the cross in mind, you know, because that is the mark of his character. That is the depth of his love. He's a sacrificially loving God. So this didn't happen. It was an emergency decision on God's part. He says, you know, I'm creating these human beings. I'm going to relate to them. I'm going to form a people no matter what it takes. And that, you know, that was the depth of that commitment. All right? And so Jesus makes the story one story. He wraps around the whole thing. All right? Okay? Questions on any of that? And we started with that because, you know, it's through the lens of Jesus that all this stuff really begins to make sense for us. And that's the whole center of the Bible. Now I'm going to go back to the Old Testament. The redemptive story of the Old Testament, if you would ask anybody, even today, you know, Jewish people, what's the center of the story of God? They would say the Exodus, right? God's mighty act of deliverance to call us to himself. So let's take a look at that. The Exodus is, and you can turn to Exodus chapter 6. We're going to land there, look at a few things. The Exodus in the Old Testament reveals God's true character and purposes to his people and to those who happen to be on the outside of it but caught up in it. And so the Exodus is like central to Israel's identity and understanding of God. In Hosea 13, which we should do a study on sometime. Let me turn there. Turn with me. Find Hosea. Keep your finger in Exodus.
get you over here.
Hosea 13. Those are the pages that are still stuck together. You know, in your Bibles, if you have those old leaf ones. But that's where the study, I think Hosea is one of the most beautiful books in the Bible. Especially when you talk about God's covenant love. Hosea 13, you there, everybody? A couple still leafing. Okay, I'm going to start with verse 3. And God is speaking to Hosea about people. Therefore, they will be like morning mist, like the early dew that disappears, like chaff swirling from a threshing floor, like smoke escaping through a window. And then he says this, but I have been the Lord your God ever since you came out of Egypt. So God marks that as an event, you know, when this relationship was forged with his people, okay? And you shall acknowledge no God but me, no Savior except me. And then he describes what this relationship has looked like. I cared for you in the wilderness, in the land of burning heat. When I fed them, they were satisfied. When they were satisfied, they became proud. Then they forgot me, okay? And that's going to be a key thing of covenant faithfulness on our part. What happens if we forget? If you read Deuteronomy, you know, which is right before they go into the promised land, and just mark in every place you find where God says, remember or don't forget. It's just loaded with it. In fact, in 1 Peter, you don't have to turn there, but 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 21. You know, Peter's writing to the covenant community of God, and he's encouraging them, says, you've been given everything you need to participate in the divine life. And he goes on, and he lists all this stuff. And he says, if these things are in you and growing, then it will make you useful to God in his, you know, purposes in this world. But then he says this, if they're not, then you have forgotten of the forgiveness of your sins. You've forgotten what God has done for you to pull you into that. So, and the same thing, there's always, one of the huge threats to covenant relationship is forgetfulness. You know, when we look at it in Exodus, that's why God said every year, Passover celebration, big event, the big event. That's why Jesus said, you know, regularly gather at the table, do this in remembrance of me, because we are prone to forget. And there are some things, if you forget, they have consequence in your life. All right? Make sense? Okay. Any questions on any of that so far? So, recall the story of the Exodus. We don't have to read it. You're all familiar with it. What are some of the key images, events related to the Exodus?
Plagues.
Okay, the plagues. What else?
Crossing the Red Sea.
What's that? Red Sea. Which plague in particular? Which one got them out?
Firstborn.
What's that?
The firstborn.
The blood. Okay, what else? Red Sea, what are some other images?
Pillar of fire. And the,
okay.
The fire pillar.
What else? Passover, okay. Good. Any others?
Burning bush.
What's that?
Burning bush.
Okay, burning bush. Where'd they go? Mount Sinai, right? Okay, we'll just stop there. Because if you look at these, and we're not going to go real deeply into this, but you take all those images and they have their New Testament parallels, you know. Just think about, you know, the Passover, the saving from the angel of death by the covering of blood. That sound New Testament-y to anybody? Mm-hmm. We are saved by the blood of the Lamb. We are protected from death because we are covered by the blood of the Lamb, right? Lots of scriptures point us to that, right, in the New Testament. John the Baptist, when he sees Jesus shows up, what does he call him? You're the Lamb. Behold the Lamb of God, right? Okay, who takes away the sins of the world. All right, and then what about the Red Sea? The idea of being delivered through water. Any New Testament connections? Baptism, maybe, huh? How about that? The sign of escape, the sign of belonging. And then what else we have? The Passover. Jesus takes the Passover and transforms it. And even that, if you just think of the potency of that and who Jesus was, that he had that much influence, because that Passover is today the defining event for Jewish people. There are years based on it. That's the big thing. You know, if there is a sacred cow in Judaism, that's it. And Jesus says it's got new meaning. And it's going to be on a different day. And they said, okay. Talk about accepting, authority and influence, right? What about Mount Sinai? Here's an interesting parallel you can look up on your own. The people are in exile in Egypt. They get delivered. They go to Mount Sinai where God establishes and brings them the law, right? Jesus, exile, right? In Egypt. He comes back. He launches in. Guess what he does after his baptism? He comes in. Matthew 5 through 7, we know it, right? The new Moses. I'm going to give you the law. You heard it said, but I say to you, right? A lot of parallels, you know, with Exodus and the New Testament and the story of Jesus unfolding there, right? Burning bush, you know, the mediator of the covenant. The New Testament says it's him. And also at Mount Sinai, there's the law is given. And the law is meant to, we're going to look at this in 2 weeks, to give order to the community's life together, right? These are the boundaries of covenant relationship. So, same thing in the New Testament, right? Jesus says, here's the boundaries of covenant relationship. Here's how you're to order your life together. And he gave him the tabernacle, which is the dwelling place and the abiding place of God where they can meet with him. He sets up the worship life of the community. Same thing in the New Testament. You know, Jesus does exactly the same thing. So there's some really, really neat parallels in that. Okay? Make sense? Okay. So when you go into the Exodus, does it go well for Moses right out of the gates? Yeah, it's kind of a rough start, right? Is that just Old Testament or is it New Testament? Is that just Old Testament? If God gives you a mission, you know, yeah, there are bumps and things didn't go well. But, you know, when he calls us to do something today, it's going to be easy, no problems, no pushback, right? It's just going to all flow. Right? Same God, same story, right? He's carrying out his redemptive purposes in a fallen world. And Jesus said, you know, this world has hated me. If you're my followers, you're going to get some of the same. Okay? Where we find, you know, dig up the expectation, if I'm a Christian, all things are going to go well and I'm going to get whatever I want and problem-free life, it's not in the Bible. You know, and it's not in the history of the Christian community for sure. Okay, Exodus 6. Am I going fast enough for you? Slow me down if you want. Yeah, really, I mean, it's really important that you get this and not that I get through it, okay? Exodus 6, verses 2 through 8. Let me read it. God also said to Moses, I am the Lord. Stop there. What's the word Lord look like in your Bibles?
All caps.
All caps? Anybody know why that is so?
Refer back to Creator.
When you see Lord in the Old Testament, it's all caps. It is that word in the Hebrew, Yahweh. Okay? Which is the personal name of God. So there you have it. So, when you see it, you know what it says. So, I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself fully known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, where they resided as foreigners. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, And if you don't mind marking your Bibles, I would encourage you, you know, as I read through this, mark every place where God says, I will. Okay? I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. And I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am Yahweh. Okay? So again, just kind of referencing this, when you see Lord, it's Yahweh. And that's been kind of overlooked and I think mistreated over the years, particularly. Yahweh is the personal name of God that he gives. And people say, well, it's a verbal kind of a thing, and it means that I am or I will be, that kind of thing. God says it's his name, you know. For instance, you know, I'll meet people, and somebody asked this Sunday, hope you aren't here, but what do you want me to call you, they say, you know, Reverend or Pastor. I said, how about Martin, you know. And this is what God is doing here. He's saying, you know what, your ancestors, they knew me of God, as God Almighty, God the Provider, but you're going to know me as Yahweh. This is my name. Okay, God's saying, you know, you don't have to call me Pastor, you don't have to call me Fred, you don't have to call me, you know, Martin. You know, he said, call me Yahweh. That's the covenant name of God. And you can do a check on that, because every time you come to a major covenanting act of God, he uses that name. It says Yahweh is, you know, is the Ark of the Covenant, all those kind of places, okay? What happened in, it's actually kind of a cultic influence that caused people to shift away from using that. Around the 4th century BC, there was this idea that if you had knew somebody's name, you had power over them and that kind of thing. And plus the Jews, you know, began to think of God's name as so holy, to say it was blasphemous, that kind of thing. So they, you know, they wouldn't say it. They, you know, translated it differently. But I think God gave it to us to use it. I mean, just think about it. And I would encourage you to try this. Start using it in your prayer time, in your conversation with God. He wants you to call him by name. And if you adopt that, read Romans 8, because Jesus amps it up further than that. Right? He says, you know, bypass the first name, Jesus says. Call me Daddy. Right? Abba. And this whole idea that God is forming a people, and covenant is a relational reality. Always is. It's about relationship. And God is saying from the early on, this is going to be so personal and so intimate, it's going to blow your socks off. Because it's with me. That's not in the Bible, but similar stuff is, right? Okay? Does that make sense to you? Yahweh is the covenant name for God, and it reflects his desire for intimacy with us. It reflects his desire that at the core of this covenant redemptive work of God is this, you know, abiding with a friend, relating to him, you know, him making himself known, us knowing him, all right? And that's one of the things that it really frustrates God about idolatry. You can read Isaiah 44. It says, God says, how can you even think this is good, you know? You make stuff with your hands and you bend down and worship it. You know, there's no idols. They're just, you know, manufactured entities that you can't really relate to. But you keep going after it. So, okay. And so that's the nature of God. And a couple things here out of Exodus chapter 6. God makes promises to his people. And the prime mover, I don't know how many times it's in there, that God says, I will, I will, I will. Several promises he makes to his people in this redemptive act of Exodus. First of all, I will deliver you from oppression. He said, I'm going to bring you out. I'm going to free you from this slave life. All right? I'm going to purchase you out of that, because you're made for more than that. And these promises carry over. You know, these are redemptive promises of God. They're not just the Old Testament Exodus. They are for all people all the time. And then the second thing he promises, I'm going to create a community. In verse 7, I will take you as my people. Covenant work of God always envisions a community, not a person. All right? God always has this in mind. Is it personal with you as an individual? Yes, but if you're getting it right and you're abiding right, it's always going to press you into this. God is forming a people. He's all about family. He's all about community, okay? And that mutuality, those kinds of things. Does God at times deal with one person? Yeah, but normally it's in a mediatorial role. Moses meets him at the bush, right? We got the bush. Why do you do that? Because he just wanted to be one-on-one with Moses? He says, no, I got a whole purpose for you that's going to help me get my people right. You know, the Apostle Paul, met on Damascus Road. One-on-one, boom, right? But what did that translate into? I'm going to launch you out as mediator to the Gentiles so they can be brought into my people as well. God is always about fashioning a people. The individualistic version of Christian life and spirituality, where it's just me and God and it's just this whole thing, and if I get that right, I got it all right, it's not biblical. It's just not there. So God promises he's going to create a community. I got some passages here. I'm not sure why. Yeah. Well, let's just look at this one. In Acts 9, when Saul's attacking the Christians, what does God say to him when he meets him on Damascus Road?
Why are you
persecuting me? Yeah, I mean, this relationship, this community, God identifies with it so strongly. You know, it has that kind of level in life to it. So God, so part of the covenant redemptive work of God and his deliverance is out of oppression into community. Third thing, it does have personal relationship. In verse 7, he says, I will be your God. And look what it says. I will be your God. Then you will know that I am Yahweh. Yes, 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 yes. It's a deeper knowing than just Lord, kind of the boss kind of thing, okay? So he has that personal relationship, and that is a knowing relationship. And then fourthly, he promises a life and blessing. He says in verse 8, I will bring you to the land I swore to Abraham. I will give it to you as a possession. And then the key thing on this all is down at the very bottom of verse 8, the very last phrase, what is it?
I am the Lord.
I am the Lord. Right, right. In other words, he's saying, and you can bank on this. He says, I'm making you all these promises. You know, I'm going to make you a people, and you're going to know me as Yahweh, blah, blah, blah. And the reason you can know this is so, he takes and he signs his name to it. Because I'm Yahweh. When I promise, I do it. When I covenant, I keep it. So if you're wondering about whether you can get delivered out of oppression or whether you belong in the community or whether you can have a personal relationship with God or do, and whether there is life and blessing in store for you, go back to who promised it. You can count on it. Okay? That's the substance of this whole thing. All right? Good. Where am I at time, George?
You're at 7:22.
When do we stop?
7:22.
Like soon. Okay. All right. all right. Done for that. That's all gone. What's the next assignment in your book? Genesis, what is it? The study thing.
Genesis 1 and 2.
And what's it say?
It says, viewing this as God's self introduction to his people, what are key things you learn about God?
Okay, let me make sense of that, then I'm going to give you time to do that. Here's the thing. Exodus, the people are delivered out of slavery, and that, you know, God's acts of deliverance is always out of something and into something. All right? It's out of slavery, out of oppression, into life, into covenant. The same thing is true for us. It is out of sin, out of darkness, into light, into life. It's out of oppression, into freedom. It's always both. You know, the redemptive work of God, it always has both avenues. In New Testament, you see it. Hey, if God has given you power to put off the old self, guess what you do? Put on the new. Yeah. So it always has those two dynamics. Now, God delivers these people, and then here's the interesting thing. Then the creation, the first readers of the creation story, the first hearers of it, were those who had already been delivered. All right? It is given to the covenant community of God, that part of the story, after they are delivered. Okay? And some good reasons for that. God saves his people and then he gives them his word because that's only then that it really makes sense to them. And so when God does, when he gives the creation story, he's basically saying to them, hey, I want you to know me a little bit more. I'm going to give you some of your own, you know, my history. Because they're wondering, who is this God, right? They didn't know. I mean, what kind of God can do this kind of stuff, right? I mean, he messes with creation. And so, you know, they're in the midst of it. They're not thinking of those questions. They're just like going, wow, you know, this is crazy. Who can treat Pharaoh like he's a puppet, you know? Those kinds of things. But then afterward, God gives them the creation story as a self-introduction. And so, again, if you're going to understand a story, you got to understand the context in which it was received. The first readers of the creation story were the people who are newly redeemed and set free. And so God's saying, hey, I want you to know who I am. And I'm going to take that story back to the very beginning of time. You want to know how I did what I did? Look, I made it all to begin with. Okay, does that make sense? You with me on that? And then it also is an introduction to who they are. That what God, his covenant work and covenant act towards them isn't just a new start in history. It traces all the way back. The first 11 chapters of Genesis, is set up in panels that were this generation to this generation to this generation to this generation. So God's basically saying, here's some of your genealogical history. From a redemptive standpoint. Does that make sense? You with me on this? Because you're going to discuss it. I hope you are. Okay. So with that in mind, what was the questions? Read Genesis 1 and 2.
Yeah. And then viewing this as God's self-introduction to his people, what are the key things you've learned about God?
Yeah. So read Genesis 1 and 2. You don't have to read it. I mean, you most know the story. You can look at it and pull some things out. But here's God saying, hey, I want you to know some things about me. So if you read Genesis 1 and 2 from that vantage point, what is God telling his redeemed people about himself? Okay, go for it. Encountered? What are some of the things from Genesis 1 and 2 that God reveals about himself to his newly called people?
Omnipotence.
Okay, his creator.
His power.
Power.
Provider.
Provider.
Caring.
Caring. What did you say? Did you say it wrong?
Omnipotent.
Omnipotent. Okay. Power. All right,
relational.
What else? What's that?
Relational.
Relational.
Faithful.
What's that?
Faithful.
Faithful.
Energetic.
Energetic. Right, yeah. Showed up every day, right?
He talked about the Trinity in the first chapter.
Okay, so how do you want to put that down? What did God say about himself?
There's more than one of them.
Okay. That God,
many parts.
Here, yeah, God in and of himself is about community. What else? Anything else?
When he speaks, things happen.
Okay, yeah. Words, his words have effect. All right, anything else?
He got tired.
Okay, he rested.
Yeah, he rested.
Yeah, he lived on a rhythm.
Get a sense of order.
Okay.
He must have been perfect for me.
Okay. Basically, God introduces himself as king and sovereign over all creation. When he gets these people out, and they go through the Red Sea, they're gathered around, and wherever that story was, you know, given to them and recorded, basically God says, let me just tell you, you won't know why I was able to do what I did? Because I am king and sovereign over everything. Which, by the way, Jesus models when he comes as well. You know, the miracles of the plagues and stuff, as well as the miracles of Jesus, are never meant to be instances in and of themselves. They are pointers to, well, the disciples ask, what kind of person is this? What kind of person can tell the storm to stop and it stops? Well, the king and sovereign of all creation. So again, events are never self-interpreting. They got to tie back to what's the purpose behind them, okay? And so God does that, and he calls them out. Let me just give you some of these things that I wrote down relative to this. So God is sovereign over all things. That has an implication. God has the right to rule over all things. Okay? If you read this, if you read the story, there's a creator who is alone and separate, distinct from all the rest. Everything else is creation. In fact, that's where things go wrong in the human creation in Genesis 3. We thought it could be otherwise, right? That God alone is God. Right? If you read Genesis 1 and 2, there's not this competing plethora of, you know, this God, that God, this God, this God. There's just one. And he's the one who started it all, sustains it all, keeps it all going. You know, all creation is the bounds of God's kingdom is all of creation, which is important for them, and I think important for us too, because God was basically saying, I'm not one of these tribal gods that you've run into before. I'm not just here for you. I got a bigger scope of kingdom, you know, that's going on here. So he communicates that creation is distinct and dependent upon the Creator. Okay. Which a lot of the world's views today that, you know, creation and all this kind of stuff is spiritual as God, or is God, you know, pantheism kind of versions of faith today. Creation is the recipient of God's providential care. Some of you noticed that. Creation is good, right? And creation is the object of God's redemptive concern. But also in that story, you know, he's saying, he's not just introducing himself. He's saying to these newly redeemed people, here's some things you need to know about yourselves, right? That you are made to relate to me. Right? Creation story points that out. The human creation was made to relate to God. And when they don't, things don't go well, right? And you're made to relate to creation. I mean, if you look at Genesis 1 and 2, particularly as a covenant, Adam becomes the mediator of the good God to the rest of creation. And that's sustainable because if you read Romans 8, it talks about the whole creation is waiting for the restoration of God's sons and daughters. You know? And so when you look at mediatorial role, which Adam was given, which we are given as the people of God, what we do impacts more than just us. Hmm?
You mean Adam still has a role? Is that what you're saying?
We do. Well, Adam's influence is still being felt. You know, when he abandoned his post as mediator, caring and keeping the creation as God would have him, all of creation suffered as a result. Right? Mm-hmm. And so that mediatorial role is huge. Okay? And so he relates to creation, and also that human beings are made to relate to one another. I mean, you saw that in Genesis and this ideal kind of situation. Okay? All right. Make sense? Now, we didn't get to this. I was hoping to, but here's the next thing. Understanding that's what creation, this is the God that delivered us. This is where how everything was fashioned. That's the first part of the story. This is how it all started out. God of his own free and gracious will says, I'm going to create some stuff. And I'm going to put some people in there. And everything in creation, you read the story, he says, you know, after their own kind, likeness, except for human beings who are made in the likeness of God. So they're unique in creation, okay? So God makes them, says, you're going to be my image bearers, as nothing else is. The relationship that you can have with me is going to be reciprocal to the degree that it is with nothing else in all of creation. And you are going to be the mediators of my goodness, and you're going to keep and multiply and, you know, watch over the creation, right? So that's all there. That's how it all started. Now, with that in mind, and I'm just going to leave it as a question because we don't have time. It is only when you understand and see the depth of that that you'll begin to understand and see the horror of sin. That's what we fouled up. Okay? That's what went wrong. Okay, and the essence of sin is the human being's flight from God. When we said, I can pull this off of my own. I don't have to stand in this role as created. Right? And so to understand the depth of sin, you got to understand the beauty and wonder of what God started with. And sin tainted the whole thing. And the rest of the Bible from Genesis 3 on is answering the question, what is God going to do about this? How is he going to deal with this horror? That these things that he made and, you know, turned against him, turned on him, turned away from him. Okay? And that's where the idea of covenant is so powerful and beautiful, because God doesn't turn away from covenant. I'm going to make a people. And they're going to be my people, and I'm going to be the God. I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to start over. I'm going to see it through. Okay? I got to end. Over time. Any last thoughts, questions? Got 10 seconds. Go ahead.
You said that sin, you said sin tainted the image of God. Or that image that, what it's supposed to be.
All of creation, including us. Yeah. Yeah. Sin infects everything. All right, let me pray and we'll go. Father, thanks again for your presence here, for revealing yourself, that that's just the kind of God you are. And you keep wanting us to know. You keep inviting us in to know you and to abide in you and to so that we can know who you are, but also that we can understand who we are. That while you haven't given up on us, that you continue to hold fast to that covenant promise and that covenant keeping, even when we would turn away from it. So we thank you for that kind of love and just pray that it would filter into us more and more. Lord, we thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.